Thank you guys for coming today to celebrate Granny and Pauline. And I just want to sing this song and let us all just celebrate her life today. I'm kind of homesick for the country at which I've never, oh, never been before. No sad goodbyes will there be spoken.
Father, I pray for those here today as we celebrate Miss Pauline's life. Lord, I pray that through her life, through her stories, through her legacy, Lord, Father, I pray that each one in here today knows beyond a shadow of a doubt that you are their Lord and Savior. And Lord, if not, I pray that now would be the time. I couldn't think of a better time and a better place than here to celebration of a child of God for Miss Pauline Hicks. Lord, to give their life to Jesus Christ, Lord, and that celebration in heaven that will break out. So, Father, I pray, Lord, for this family, Lord, in the days ahead and the hours ahead and even the moments ahead as we continue this service. Lord, I pray for Ricky and Roy, Lord, as you have given them words to say as well, Lord. And I praise you for Brooklyn, dear God, and just sing Beulah Land. God, just everything that's said and done, Lord, I pray today, Lord, just gives you glory and honor and praise. And it's in the mighty name of Jesus Christ I do pray. Amen. You know, times like this, you always wonder what in the world am I going to say that you hadn't heard before. And there's nothing. Nothing that I can say that you hadn't heard before. You know, some things are just reminders. Certainly an honor to be able to stand here today and to share some words of your mom, your grandmother, your great-grandmother, your friend. My goodness, the family list goes on. I tell you, it's a great honor. And family, I do want you to know that if I can be there to assist you in any way, just let me know. I'll do my best. But I do want to thank you for this opportunity. And you know, I thought about all the times growing up, and you know, going over at Miss Pauline's house and Bill's house, and I don't think Pauline ever changed. I don't think her looks ever changed. If you look in the picture, you know, they always look the same. I know last week I told her, Debbie went over there, and I said, Miss Pauline, she was answering kind of yes and no questions. I said, you look pretty good, and I got a stare. And I thought, I know she knows how to use a hickory, and I thought, uh-oh. but she did. I thought she looked good. She looked like Miss Pauline. I mean, it's amazing. She was an amazing lady. But Sunday, May the 12th, on Mother's Day, she went home to be with the Lord. You know, she joined the great cloud of witnesses that is spoken of in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1. And in that great cloud of witnesses, it's her testimony. It's their testimony that's left behind. Their testimony of how they love the Lord. The testimony of how they love their family. The testimony of how they live their life. And lived it in the glory of the Lord. And she was able to join that great cloud. It's kind of like a cheerleader, you know, and family and friends. You know, I believe that her legacy, that's what it's all about, is cheering you on. It is prodding you, pushing you. You can do this. You can make it. You know, she was blessed with 84 years. And when we think about time, you know, 84 years is not that long. You know, I guess for some of the kids in here, they probably think, wow, you know, 84 years. But it doesn't take long to realize that 84 years is but a vapor, doesn't it? And that's what the Bible speaks of, is that's what our life is. So what are we filling that little span with? What are we filling that vapor with? You know, I think Miss Pauline, probably if she were to say anything to you right now, she would say, y'all shouldn't make a big fuss about my life. That's probably the one thing. But I believe that she would be quite proud, Ricky, when she looked out and saw the church that she loved, to see so many people here on her account for celebrating her life in the Lord. I think she would be excited. I really think that would put a smile on her face and joy in her heart. But 84 years, you know, death is something we can't escape. There are several passages in the Word of God that talks about life, that talks about death. And Job chapter 14, verse 5, a man that saw many sorrows and joys in his life, just like Pauline, saw the up, saw the down, saw many different sides of life, said this, says, since his days being man, since his days are determined, the number of his months is with you, being the Lord, you have appointed his limits so that he cannot pass. You know, and so when we think about Miss Pauline, nothing took her. There was no sickness that took her. There was no age that took her. It was time to go home. And I think when you put things in a biblical perspective, when you put her life and the celebration today in that biblical perspective, it brings some easement because it was time to go home. Preparations had been finished. We're not made to stay here on this earth in this current condition, but such a certain amount of time. And, you know, in a way, praise the Lord for that because of all the things that this world brings. But, you know, Vernon, we spoke on Sunday. I said, you know, this is what we're born again for. This is what Miss Pauline was born again for. Family, that's what I want you to remember. This is what Miss Pauline was born again for, to live forevermore in the presence of the Savior. You know, so today, if you'll notice the words that has already been said numerous times by several people, nobody's used the word funeral, have they? Because we're not at a funeral. Funeral is for those that are dead, but those that who have died being born again in Christ Jesus, they live forevermore. So we're celebrating today, even though I know there's pain there. I know that there's hurt there. But you know, I thought about it. She was so blessed with so many things. What are some of the things that she experienced in her life? And y'all know a lot of things that she saw in her life. I know a lot of things that she saw in her life. Again, we were practically neighbors. We were there walking distance. We'd walk back and forth. I think I was there for the first trampoline. I was there for the swimming pool. I was there for the boats. I was there for the wave runners. We were all there. We'd have to go try them out, you know. The perks of being a friend, right? but you know, I was there for a lot of things that she enjoyed. She enjoyed seeing y'all with some of the cars. Dennis, I was there when you wrecked the Mustang, and I was there. I remember those times. You can't forget some of those times, can you? And I know that y'all do. I was there when some of you got weapons. We won't talk about that. But I know she knew how to use a hickory. And it didn't matter if you were family or not. She knew how to use a hickory, among other things. You know, what did she experience in her life? What did she see? Well, I got 10 things that I want you to think about. I'm going to say these real quick. She saw World War II begin. She was there. Something that was pretty amazing in the population today, she saw an increase of 209 million people in the population. There's a reason why they called it the good old days, right? 209 million people, which she added to that, by the way, by quite a bit, didn't she? We look at the family and the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren. She added to the population. She also saw the attack on Pearl Harbor. She saw D-Day begin. Jackie Robinson, she saw the Major League Baseball race barrier broken with Jackie Robinson. She saw the first color TV. What do you think about that, young folks? I'm like, there was anything else? You know, that's what Some of them are thinking she was there. She experienced that. Disney World, when it was being built, she saw that. She was able to experience that. She also experienced Alaska being admitted as the 49th state, John F. Kennedy assassinated, and the first Super Bowl. Thought, yeah, that's pretty interesting. She lived through some of those times, and that's just a fraction of some of the things that she experienced. Some of those things were great, wasn't it? Some of those things were wow moments, and some of those things were heartbreaking moments. You know, the president assassinated, D-Day, World War II, those things that, Pearl Harbor, those things that strike fear sometimes in your heart. She experienced all those things. She saw all those things. You know, she also was blessed and granted to be a daughter and to be a friend. And I praise the Lord today that I was able to be her friend and the family's friend throughout a lifetime. She was blessed and granted to be a wife, a sister, a mother of six boys. You know, that right there showed how tough she was to be a mother of six boys. And I want to tell you something. I told Kevin when we talked on the phone, I said, you know, and she could still handle every one of you just like that. I mean, she was able to. You know, but God allowed that for her. God granted that to her. Also granted her to be the grandmother of 16 grandchildren and 26 great-grandchildren. I don't know. That's a life accomplishment. You know, and for her to hold up as well as she did, that's saying something about your mom. That's saying something about Miss Pauline. But, you know, there was much, much more that she was allowed to be part of in this life that God allowed her to be part of. You know, weddings and again, the birth of those children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren and those prom moments and all those special times in your life, those times that will never be forgotten, she was allowed to be a part of that. All those ups and downs of life, she was allowed to be a part of that. But you know, the Word of God in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9, Paul wrote to the church, and he said something because, you know, all we can do is begin to think back on our life. Begin to think, like, what would it have been like? And all we can do is think. If you weren't there, you can think. As a matter of fact, if you experienced some of those things as well that I just shared, the experiences are different for different individuals, aren't they? We take those differently. So we really don't know sometimes exactly how she took everything when it's inside of her. But you know, when Paul wrote to the church, here's what he said in chapter 2, verse 9 of 1 Corinthians. He said, but as it is written, eyes not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for those who love him. So there was a greater reward. When she took her last breath on Sunday, there was a greater reward. There was things we can read about in the Bible, we can try to understand. You know, it says in verse 10, God has revealed them to us through his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. But there's some things we don't experience until we're there. Heaven is one of those. You know, when we talk about a place with no more dying, we certainly don't understand that, do we? When we talk about a place with no more sin or no more sickness, the consequences of sin, that's why we're here today. It's upon all of us. We don't understand that, do we? A place where there's no more arguing and fussing and fighting, no more hatred, where people love one another and they genuinely care for one another. We don't fully understand that, do we? A place with no issues, a place with no problems. And that's where, because of her faith in Jesus Christ, that's what your mom experienced in that. Not one day has passed. There's no need. But she's experiencing that because on the day that the Holy Spirit of God came knocking on her heart's door, she opened that door and said, come in. And the Lord came in and fellowshiped with her, stayed with her, sealed her until the day of redemption. Isn't that amazing when we think about a God who loves us that much to send his Son, Jesus Christ, on the cross of Calvary for us? We could stand here all day, I guarantee you, and go around the room, but we'd probably have everybody share. Just our, we got limited to five good things Miss Pauline has done for you. And you could probably all do it. But you know what? You could probably say, well, you know, what's some of the things that didn't go her way? And people could share that too, right? Why? Because we're people saved by the grace of a holy God. No one is perfect except for the Lord. That's why Jesus Christ died on the cross of Calvary. She knows when she stands before the Lord because of her Savior. Can you imagine? I hope every one of you here today knows that you will hear these words when you stand before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Enter in, my good and faithful servant. That's what Miss Pauline wanted for you. She wanted the best for you. Did she make mistakes? Absolutely. Who don't? Everybody makes mistakes. Everybody. But I want to tell you something. I know for me, this was a fine lady. This was somebody to be remembered. This is somebody that can't be replaced. You know, we lost touch some through the years, but to the root of growing up can never be replaced. I was there pretty much with every one of y'all growing up, and y'all seen me in diapers and sniveling, you know? And y'all seen me when I was older and sniveling too, didn't you? You know, sometimes because Miss Pauline got on to me and I'd walk home mad because I was close enough until finally go home. So, you know, think about what she's experiencing now. And think about what she taught you. Think about what she taught you. She prepared you for this day. You just happen to dig in and find it. She prepared you how to get through these times because she went through many of them herself. She went through many. And I want to close with this. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, probably something we all know very well. You know, because if we're not careful, we try to get caught up into being good enough, being good enough. I believe everybody here wants to go to heaven. I believe there's a soul in here right now. And I say, if there's somebody that doesn't want to be in heaven, let me know. I believe everybody will say, of course I want to be there. Well, how can you be there? How did Miss Pauline make it? How was she able to do this? Well, Ephesians 2, 8, 9 says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. And that faith is in Christ Jesus and all of the finished work he's done on that cross of Calvary. From Genesis to Revelation, all the works of a holy God, everything he's done for you. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. So I couldn't think of a greater time today than if that gift is being offered to you of salvation to take it. It's almost pictured like this. There was a day in Miss Pauline's life that God held out the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. He said, Miss Pauline, it's yours. It's yours. I want you to be my child. And she reached out and she took it. So I want to ask you today, have you reached out and took the gift of a holy God? The only way you'll ever see Miss Pauline again is through Jesus Christ. I do not want to mince any words at this point. I do not want to make it unclear. For a child of God, we'll be able to see her again. But for those who are not, this is a goodbye. Isn't that sad? When it's offered, free, it was offered to her and she took it. It was offered to you dead and you took it. It was offered to Bill and he said, I'll take that over everything I got because it was the most precious. So today, if you don't know Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, don't let another moment slip by without crying out to him through faith and believing in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Again, family, thank you so much for this privilege and opportunity. It really is special to me. It means the world to me. If I can be there, please, please let me know.
looking up to the sky. And you're praying, Lord, you know what's best, but I don't understand why. If you could hear your loved ones speaking now to you, they'd say you wouldn't be grieving if you only knew. If you only knew, I just go and hold your prayers out there. My sickness is gone. Things look much better from heaven's view. The sun always shines. We're having a time if you only knew. To be out and from the valley is present with the Lord. I'm in the arms of Jesus now. I'm not suffering anymore. Hand in hand we'll stroll together down Heaven Avenue. We're having a big celebration if you only knew. If you only knew, I'm just going home. Your prayers have been answered. My sickness is gone. Things look much better from heaven's view. The sun always shines. We're having the time if you only knew. Things look much better from heaven's view. The sun always shines. We're having a time if you only
knew. In reading this morning, the 31st chapter of Proverbs, most of you know that's where the passage is about the virtuous woman. And I would say that would have to, as I read through it, I said, wow, how much of this applies to Pauline? How much of it? But I want to only read the last verse and a half. That's where I want to go this afternoon. And that says, but a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Pauline filled many places of responsibility in her life. First of all, she was a daughter. She was a sister. She was a wife. Then she became a mother, a grandmother, a great-grandmother, a bookkeeper, an aunt, a cousin, a friend, a neighbor, all different kinds of words that we could use to describe Pauline's life. Sometimes I try to make the services as personal as I can, and I sometimes ask families to give me quickly, I say right quickly, the first thing that comes to your mind when you think about Pauline, what is that word? And sometimes they're able to do it very, very easily. You know, there's different kinds of the thoughts and situations that families find themselves in. I have taken Pauline's name, P-A-U-L-I-N-E, and made an acrostic out of it. Now, be careful. These are my thoughts. You may have a different words or words that you would like to apply to Pauline, but these are my words, my thoughts, as I served as an associate pastor at Sunnyside while they were still there, and have been blessed by their lives, her and Bill both. But Pauline Hicks, how would you describe Pauline Hicks? And I guarantee you, as you said, people went around the room, we could find all kind of answers, all kind of praise for Pauline. Pauline Hicks, the P in her name, I think stood for proud. She was a proud lady. I watched her. She was always neat, clean. The only time I saw her a little bit mussed was in the garden. And that was just impossible to stay clean and dry in the garden in the summertime. She was proud. She was proud of you as her family. She was proud of her relationship with Bill. She was proud of her relationship to the Lord. Proud, Pauline Hicks. A, she was authentic. She was real. She didn't change from person to person or from situation to situation. Pauline was the same every time you saw her. And Dennis, I guarantee you, if you didn't want to know what she thought, you better not ask. Because she would tell you. Authentic. The you in Pauline. Unselfish. In the summertime, they blessed us with fresh vegetables. Bill cut down some blackberry vines and gave me vines to put out down at my house. They didn't survive for some reason. I probably didn't take good care of them, but they didn't survive. She was unselfish in her time, in her energy. L, loving. Everyone here knows about the love that Pauline Hicks had for us, you and me. She loved, she cared. The I in Pauline. I would say, independent. And I suspect that I will talk about it later, Dennis, but after Bill died, I suspect you learned a whole lot about her independence, that she had a mind of her own, and she was going to do what she wanted to, whether you liked it or not. She was independent, as most of us are, if we would admit it. We want to be independent. We want to take care of ourselves, and she was blessed in that sense. Now, the N in Pauline's name, I had a little difficulty with. I couldn't come up with a good word. And finally, I came up with the word naughty. Not bad. Not a bad sense of being naughty. I would say just a little bit mischievous. She loved to laugh. She loved when she'd get something on you that she'd hold over your head. She liked practical jokes at times, too. She and Bill got after me several times with these practical jokes that they did, little quirks and things. And she enjoyed it. And I loved to hear her laugh. And then the E in Pauline. I would say they would have to be energetic, because she was never still. You looked around the house and the grass was cut and the shrubs were trimmed. Everything was neat and clean and in its place. She was energetic. She loved to be outdoors. She loved flowers. I haven't asked Dennis this, but I'll bet you had to hide the keys to the lawnmower so she wouldn't get on it. Am I right or wrong? Right. Because she was going to take care of things at the house. Pauline Hicks, one of a kind, a beautiful, loving, kind lady that I'm proud to say was my friend. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the day. I pray, Father, that you'll fill this day with your presence, with your courage, with your strength, that you, Father, will surround us with a sweet awareness that you are here to hold us in a time of need. You're here to support us in our sorrow. And I pray, Father, that today will be a special day. We thank you, Father, for the life of Pauline. We thank you for the friendship that she shared with us. And we pray in Jesus' name.
Retire, we'll still be around. But she said, no, I want my preacher. to do my service. So I guess I can retire now. In my membership, I'm just kidding. But you heard all these other things from these other preachers about some great words, and I just want to add to those words and the greatness of our relationship. Well, 13 years ago on Sunday morning, Pauline and Bill walked here about halfway up on the left side and come into East Nolet Baptist Church. It was a blessing to see them. I hadn't seen them in a lot of years, and little did I know that I would be their pastor. Little did I know I'd be bringing a message one day about them. It was a great honor for me to become their pastor back then. It's a great honor now. But we went through heartaches together. That's what pastors do. We had the pastor here this morning with us. We got two back here. We go through the heartaches with the family. And Pauline lost Bill. I know it was a great heartache. And I'm glad I was her pastor to help her through those things and go through grief and pain. About 51 years ago, I married my wife, Carol, and we were very soon to have a son, Donald. And Carol was working at Penline Garment, and I was a shoe drop hanger. And didn't have a lot of money. We had an old trailer we were living in. And Carol had to continue to work for us to get on our feet. And we didn't have nobody to keep Donald. Little saved, Miss Pauline stepped up and kept Donald. Some of the boys remember Donald. And you could pay her or not pay her. If we didn't have the money, we didn't have to pay her. She was there to just take care of our family, and she would keep Donald anyway. Carol said, we talked about it life another day. Pauline did one of the greatest things somebody could do to help you. She helped to wean Donald off the bottle. You ladies know how hard that can be, but Pauline helped her. But one of the things, I'm going to just a few things, and Pauline was strict. And we know that. Boys, y'all know that. She let you know what was on her mind. And she once told me at Vacation Bible School, said, those youngins need their tail tore. I said, Pauline, we can't whoop somebody else's young. She said, well, they need their tail tore. I said, I agree. They need a good history on the backside, what she said, and I know. I bet there's more than one here that had that hickory or bell on their backside, especially on these sick boys. And we think about Brother Joy. But you know, maybe she had the right way of thinking. It turned out pretty good. And spanking and whipping. And I know you tell the mentor quite a few times, boys. Pauline was a defensive woman. She'd take up for her family, she'd fight you, she'd take up for her pastor. Many years ago, before Bill passed, Bill had seemingly been treated disrespectful in the church by one of the church members. That happens sometimes to pastors, we get treated that way. And Bill happened to notice it. He got mad about it, and he said, I'm going to tell them deacons they need to go to her, and she needs to apologize to you. And I thought, oh, don't do that, Bill. And I remember when Bill was saying that, Pauline said, if he don't, I will. And I said, man, y'all gonna get me thrown out of this church. I ain't been here but a couple of years. She was just defensive. And your family, you know that. Each one of them, you know that about it. And one of the things, I don't know why Joy ain't mentioned it, is the cooking she done. Amen on that cooking. When Pauline came, it wasn't long before the church knew how well she cooked. Now, East Nolet had to cook. I mean, great cook. We laid that, you know, that's why they kept a fat preacher. They had some good food going on, and Pauline just added to that. And just a great cook. She was known for her cupcakes. And we'd always say at table, we got quite a few laborers make homemade cakes. And her with the coconut cake is always laid out there. And it was on the table, and everybody would watch to see if there's a piece left when the fellowship was over, but they could take that piece home with them. But look at that, there wouldn't be nothing but crumbs. Preacher would get that crumb, that's the best part, coconut cake and stuff. She's a great cook. Proverbs 31:15 said, she rises also while it's yet night and giveth meat to her household and a portion to her maidens. That's a powerful verse because it applied so well to Pauline. She cooked for her family. She cooked for anyone there. I'm sure they ate meals there. Roy's probably had fellowship with them. And it says here, in a portion to her maiden. In other words, she would cook for everybody. Not just the boys or family, she would cook for everybody. It's something she did here. I asked Pauline, how many biscuits did you cook every morning? She just smiled and wouldn't ever tell me. I knew any boy they had a bunch of biscuits, you go look at them. And she said, well, they really love biscuits around the house. I said, Pauline, why don't you just get some old canned biscuits? Some of those Mama B's biscuits and feed them. So that boy knows the difference. They're not going to eat nothing but them homemade biscuits. And she looked at me like it was a bad word or something. I remember Keith was here at one of our brotherhoods. And in brotherhood, we, us men, don't know how to make biscuits. We'd have either canned biscuits or Mama B frozen biscuits or something. I remember Keith being here, and he had canned biscuits. He looked at me and said, I can't eat them things. I said, what do you mean you can't eat? Cut them up with gravy. He said, I can't eat them things. He's always ate his Mama's biscuits. They was always so good. And I believe Dennis told Carol the other day that sometimes she would cook over 50 biscuits. That's a biscuit. At May Vacation Bible School, Pauline would always serve in the kitchen, and she would bring something for the workers to eat. And most of the time, it would be chicken and dumplings. And I don't know why she didn't make two pots of it. It'd always be one. And we'd fag over trying to get that bowl hid back for my wife and myself. If I waited later, it'd all be gone. And she put a bowl aside for me. She said, I got you some dumplings back there. I said, well, amen, Pauline. But there's another food story I always remember. It's most powerful. And we hear what Proverbs said in a portion to her maidens. After Bill passed, we would go out to eat together a lot of our church on Sunday evening after services. We'd go to Wendy's and we'd go to Arby's and we'd have a burger together after services, fellowship and time. And Pauline would spend Sunday after church cooking some kind of dessert. And when we went in Wendy's or Arby's, wherever we went, Pauline would have plates, knives, cobblers, whipped cream, and we'd go in there. We didn't even want the hamburgers after seeing all that, but we'd go in there. And we'd go in there, and I noticed everybody be looking. Man, I wish I had some of that. And before it's over, Pauline doesn't share it with nobody in there. There'd be some left over. She said, y'all want some of this? Y'all want some of this? But she shared, just like it says in Proverbs 31. She loved to cook, and it was a labor of love for her. And I was thinking Carol was going through some of her recipes night before last that Pauline had given her. And what she done, I said, pick three of those recipes for the cakes you like. And I believe one off the coconut bread, velvet, and coconut cream, I believe. On that vestibule, when you go out on that table, there's recipes for all of them. And I believe Pauline left you, if you love to have one, ladies or men, there's copies of those recipes of those cakes she used to make, and they out there for you. When you leave, they on the left, you're welcome to. Pauline loved her husband. Matthew 19:5-6 and said, for this cause shall man leave father, mother, shall cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. Wherefore they are not no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let us let no man put asunder. The Bible said, cleave and become one. Bill and Pauline were married for 58 years. And the reason they was married for 58 years, they had cleaved. They had become one. They weren't two. They weren't separate. When there were problems in the business or something going on, that they were one. When the family would be having some kind of issues, as all families do, they would be one. They would be together. When sickness and death would happen, they would be one. That's why they stayed together 58 years through sickness and health. Whatever goes on, they stuck together. When they went to Pigeon Forge, I loved it when they went to Pigeon Forge with their cars and set up there. They were one. They was always just having time. We can take an example of that family. How a family can stay together till death is because you cleave under one. Through hard times, bad times, family issues, you cleave and you stay together. They were one all through their life. And I got to thinking about Bill. Hey, we all know Bill. And Bill, he's like a little hornet sometimes, and he got riled up. And he don't believe me yet, more than concrete. But But I got to thinking about Bill, and I went to the Word of God and realized the strength comes through the woman in the family. Now, Genesis 2:18 says that the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him and help me for him." Our God knew that us men would mess up. That's basically what it's saying here. If he didn't think that, why would we need a woman? And he gave us the woman to help me, that the Word of God says, and to help us get out of the mess. I'm sure she had to calm Bill down sometimes, being mad. I'm sure a lot of things went on, and she had to calm him down. She was the calm in the storm. When Bill was upset that something happened in his life, she was the calm in the storm. Well, that's what the Word of God says. And that went on for 58 years. She was a perfect helpmeet for Bill. And who else could handle Bill? And the boys don't know that, but Miss Pauline. And Proverbs 31:11, Brother Roy had said, part of the husband does safely trust in her. She loved her husband. She loved her family. Boys, and she always called y'all boys when she was speaking here, talking to me, and just in a matter-of-fact way, she'd call y'all boys. Y'all never did good grown in her eyes. You were still her youngest, she loved your wives, and the grandkid, the great-grandkids, she had a great love for every one of them. It always blessed me. She'd bring them grandkids to church with her, and they were just the grandkids mine, too. I assure you, when she brought them grandkids here, they mine. But the greatest thing, I know she had a love for her brothers and sisters, just friends, but the greatest thing about it, she loved the Lord. I was in my daily Bible reading, when she was in her first days at the hospital in North Georgia, and she was getting a little worse, and she's not doing well, and the scripture brought a smile on my face, how if I got to do a service, if she passed, the scripture that God tells me is so important here. And the scripture is Romans 14:8. It says, "For whether we live unto the Lord. And whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live, therefore, or die, we are the Lord's." Whatever's going on, we are the Lord. Pauline lived for the Lord. She died for the Lord. She lived in a way that showed her love for Christ. She lived in a way that Verse 12 of Romans 14, it says, "So then every one of us shall give account of himself to God." She can truly give a great account to the Lord. She lived that life. I believe Pauline would have enjoyed the service today, the great singing, the great words spoken. But she would tell us, heaven awaits for those that know the Lord. Brother Joy wrote an encouraging word about salvation. She would be crying out to her family and to her friends with a burden to see them also come to know the Lord. When I heard that song, "I Fly Away," that was one of her favorite songs. She loved songs like that. On Sunday night, we'd sing songs like that. She loved them when we got songs. And she would want to say to each one of them, don't mess up in life. Greatest mess up, young ones, you can do in life is fail to follow Christ. It's so powerful when you think about what Christ done on the cross for us. It's so powerful to know when this day comes, in John 11:25-26 says, there's no death. There's no death for those that know Him. I just say to you this morning, I'm in this secret. If you don't know the Lord, you can talk to Roy, Joey, or me, and we can tell you how you can see Pauline again. Let's pray. Father, we come to you this afternoon, and we're going to just say we love you. We thank you, Father, how great it is to be able to just come and say encouraging words about one of your children. But her goodness is not because of her. Her goodness is because of you, Lord. We're nothing. We're filthy rags. All they knew that. All they knew we was nothing. But you never looked upon your children as nothing, and that's the great part about being a Christian, Father, being saved. You never look upon your children as nothing. Sometimes people look upon us as sorry, nothing people, no good people. But you never look at anyone of your children that way, Father. We just pray now, someone did maybe get a little encouragement, maybe their heart been stirred through the message they heard. There's nothing Pauline would like better. To see one of our family members and friends come to know you as the Lord and Savior. Father, we love you and we thank you. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.